goes on. And these are the causes of malnourishment or malnutrition in between this set of patients. Defining cancer cachexia, what exactly is cancer cachexia? It is defined as a multifactorial syndrome, which is characterized by an ongoing loss of skeletal muscle mass with or without loss of fat. And it cannot be fully reversed by conventional nutritional support and leads to a progressive functional impairment. Now, the pathophysiology is characterized by negative protein and energy balance driven by variable combination of reduced food intake and abnormal metabolism. How to diagnose this cancer cachexia? It is essentially when there's a weight loss of more than 5% over the last 6 months in absence of simple starvation, and the BMI is less than 20 with any degree of weight loss which is more than 2%, or if there is a appendicular skeletal mass index that is consistent with sarcopenia. So the cutoff would be 7.26 kg per meter square in males, and in females it is less than 5.45 kg per meter square, and along with any degree of weight loss which is at least more than 2%. Now, this is the definition of cancer cachexia. What are the stages of cancer cachexia? We have the pre-cachexic cachexic and the refractory cachexia. The pre-cachexia is essentially when there is a weight loss of less than equal to 5%. Along with that, there is anorexia and other metabolic changes. When this weight loss goes beyond 5%, or BMI less than 20 and other factors that we discussed just now, that is what when we call it as cachexia. And refractory cachexia is when there is the severity has increased to such an extent that there is an impending death, and the performance status decreases, and there is a less than 3 months of expected survival. And so how does these cancer cachexia and other stages of malnutrition influence the outcome? So first there is the anorexia and limited food intake, which is again because of various factors which I'll be discussing in the coming slides. And then there is the pre-cachexia and cachexia, and lastly the term sarcopenia. So sarcopenia is when there is a loss of muscles, and where the body reserves are depleted and the muscles are lost. Pre-cachexia and cachexia is when is when the catabolic drivers, that is the inflammatory cytokines, causes a further reduction in the nutrition intake and increase in the metabolic needs. And then anorexia is something that is caused due to the inflammatory cytokines that has affected the CNS. How exactly it happens, I'll be discussing in this slide. So essentially, when a person that has a viable tumor inside the body, it in itself is a state of inflammatory stress. And there are various cytokines, inflammatory cytokines are produced, the TNF-alpha, the interleukin-6, interleukin-1, etc. And they act on the CNS and causes anorexia. They act on the muscles and causes wasting of the muscles. They act on the liver and leading to the release of acute phase proteins from the liver. And decreases the clearance of other cytotoxic drugs that are being introduced as a treatment of the cancer. And that again causes a certain kind of stress and a vicious cycle of malnutrition. And then lastly, it acts on the fat, and that causes fat use and fat depletion. Now in this state of systemic inflammation, the results would be anorexia, the results would be weight loss and poor function. And apart from that, it leads to fatigue, pain, and other psychological symptoms like depression. That being said, as far as the outcome of the patient is concerned. Does it also affect the outcome in some way? Yes, of course it does. It is seen that 10 to 20% of the patients with cancer, the death, the 10 to 20% of the death of the cancer patient can be attributed to malnutrition per se, rather than malignancy. Physicians often misclassify the severity of cancer-related malnutrition and in namely the 40% of cases. And even though the physician has recognized the cancer-related malnutrition, the patients and their relatives often underestimate the presence. And that in turn impacts the immunity. The impacts the ability to tolerate antineoplastic treatments. It impacts the toxicity owing to the anti-cancers treatment. In stage 3, stage 4 head and neck cancer treated with multiple modality, the strongest independent predictor of survival was pre-treatment weight. And in head and neck cancer patients, it was shown to have a significant decrease in survival at two years. If the patient is malnourished, so that the percentage was 57.5 versus 7.5 as per Brooks et al. Continuing with the consequences of malnutrition, it also increases the risk of infection. It leads to higher unplanned breaks and delay in the radiotherapy administration. Toxicity is maybe so severe that it is even life threatening. Treatment interruptions are always associated with poorer outcome. And the obvious, that is the decrease in the quality of life. Even as per the UK guidelines, the malnutrition associated model, they say that the malnutrition associated morbidities are increased risk of infection, delayed wound healing, muscle weakness, depression, poor quality of life, increase in mortality rate, and increased risk of post-operative complications. Now, looking at the effect of adequate nutrition. So this adequate nutrition, if maintained, will decrease the impact of the side effects of the cancer treatment. It will decrease weight loss. It will improve the quality of life. And it will help the patient to recover from radiotherapy better. So, addressing the problem statement, the head neck cancer patients are frequently malnourished at the time of diagnosis, and in addition, chemoradiation causes an exacerbation of symptoms such as alteration and loss of taste, mucositis, xerostomia, fatigue, nausea, vomiting, and that again decreases the nutritional status of the patient. But then, how do we counter it? Because the management of nutrition or poor nutritional status itself has comes with a set of its own doubts. So what doubts do we have? First of all, when and how to identify that a patient does need an intervention? How often should the patient should be assessed to see if the patient does need intervention, and if at all intervention is given, what should be the goals of the intervention? What would be the prescription of the same, and then what should be the route of the same? So oral versus parenteral nutrition, and enteral versus parental nutrition, and if at all enteral nutrition, what should be the route of enteral nutrition? Should it be given by a nasogastric tube? Should it be given by gastrostomy? When should one be preferred over other? And lastly, prophylactic versus reactive gastrostomy or nasogastric tube intubation. So let's deal with each of the questions one by one. Slide changing. Okay, second. I'm sorry, just one second. Okay, extremely sorry for the glitch. Yeah, so let's deal with the first question. So how should patients be identified for referral to the dietitian or other nutritional support in order to maximize the nutritional intervention and opportunities? Now, I'll be dealing with a few guidelines here. And the first one is the Australian guideline. The Australian guideline says that all patients receiving radiation therapy to head and neck should be referred to a dietitian for nutritional support. So all patients, that is the answer as per the Australian guideline. Now this is the ESPEN guideline. The ESPEN guideline says that we recommend that during radiotherapy with special attention to RT of the head and neck, thorax and GI tract, an adequate nutritional intake should be ensured primarily by individualized counseling or with the use of ONS, that is oral nutritional supplements, in order to avoid nutritional deterioration and maintain intake and avoid RT interruptions. So essentially, again, they're also suggesting that should be done to all the patients receiving head and neck cancer. All the patients of head and neck cancer receiving radiotherapy. Now coming to the UK guideline, again, in the UK guideline, the recommendations are patients with head and neck cancer should be nutritionally screened using a validated screening tool at diagnosis and then repeated interval throughout the course of treatment. So even UK guideline says that all the patients should be screened. Coming to the NCCN guideline, the NCCN guideline says that the global nutritional recommendation for patients receiving CTRT should utilize oral intake as much as possible while maintaining safety and the monitor for the lifetime of the patient even well after therapy. And the factors that predict a limited enteral feeding requirement would be patients having very good performance status, and if there is no significant pre-treatment weight loss, that is 5% in the past 1 month and 10% in the past 6 months, and if there is no airway obstruction and there is no dysphagia. So the NCCN guidelines is slightly different. They have mentioned a subset of patients who would require enteral feeding requirements. But other than that, the most of the patients would may not require a support as per the NCCN guidelines. But as per the Australian, UK, and the ESPEN guidelines, all patients should be screened and looked into if the patient would need a support or not. Now, at what interval should it be done? As per the Australian guideline, patient should receive a minimum fortnightly follow-up by dietitian for at least 6 weeks of post-treatment. And during the radiotherapy, patient should be seen weekly by dietitian, and patient should be reviewed by dietitian as required up to 6 months post-treatment, and then as long as they require management for chronic toxicities, including weight loss, and if the patient does continue tube feeding. As per the UK guidelines, again, the recommendations are to perform assessment of the cancer patients frequently and initiate the nutritional intervention early when deficits are found. So the UK guideline doesn't mention weekly versus biweekly, but as per the Australian guidelines, they say that assessment should be done during radiotherapy, and that should be weekly by a dietitian. So the take-home message from this much discussion is that all patients undergoing radiation for head and neck region should receive nutritional assessment and adequate nutritional counseling, and if necessary, nutritional support according to the symptoms and the status. And now coming to the assessment. So how exactly do you assess if the patient is having a requirement for nutritional support? That should be done again from the history and the physical examination, from various anthropometric measurements if necessary. Laboratory values would be done for, what are the lab values that is given here from a proper counseling and dietitian referral. And during RT, at every assessment, weight of the patient should be noted and to look for a decrease in the weight during the course of radiation. Now, there are various tools for assessment of for the assessment of the same. So the basic simple way to measure if the patient would need support or not would be to assess if the patient has a 10% baseline weight loss and then a baseline weight loss. Other than that, there are other tools like the University of Pennsylvania Nutritionist Devised Prognostic Nutritional Index, also known as the PNI. And then we have the subjective global assessment tool, the patient-generated subjective global assessment tool, malnutrition screening tools, and malnutritional universal screening tool. Now, this entire table is from the UK guidelines, and they say that all of these tools are validated for assessment in cancer patients. Now, what would be the intervention for the same? Now, interventions would be, again, the symptomatic treatment, whatever treatment-related toxicities that are dealing with that are causing decrease in the nutritional intake would need to be managed. So if the patient is having mucositis, odynophagia, and nausea, vomiting owing to the treatment, that should be taken care of at the earliest. And then a counseling of the patient. Supplementation is necessary and an important part of the intervention that needs to be taken. Again, enteral versus parental supplementation comes into the question, and there is no doubt about it that that enteral supplementation is better than parental supplementation. What we have in the enteral one is the oral supplementations that are most preferable and most commercially viable. There comes the indication of nasogastric tube filling when there is weight loss more than 5%, and that again needs to be replaced periodically. And if gastrostomy or jejunostomy is done, then that again comes in the enteral supplement, and the enteral supplementation should be given through the same. So coming to the next question, enteral nutrition, first of all, oral versus nasogastric or gastrostomy. When should we try to continue it orally, or when to put a tube inside? Now, the enteral nutritional via nasogastric tube or gastrostomy tube indications would be if there is a severe local mucositis. So whenever there's a severe local mucositis, which might interfere with swallowing, that again should be an indication of putting a tube inside. And secondly, if the patient is a radically treated patient with obstructing head and neck cancer, that itself is interfering with the swallowing process, then a nasogastric tube or a gastrostomy should be done. And this is as per the ESPEN guideline. Now coming to the question of which one is better. Is nasogastric tube better or percutaneous gastrostomy better? And so this table compares various studies that have been taken, that have been done to compare these two modalities. And so the first study, Magne et al., said that the quality of life is better with PEG tube, and which is kind of obvious because there isn't a tube that is sticking out of the patient's nose. So the quality of life is better. Mikhail et al. Concluded that the dysphagia is more persistent with PEG at 3 to 6 months, but by 12 months, the difference between a nasogastric and a PEG tube has disappeared. And lastly, Cordy et al. Concluded that PEG patients have a higher insertion site infection rate, that is 41%. And on longer duration of use, there is more grade 3 dysphagia at 6 months. So guideline says that reactive tube feeding or nasogastric or gastrostomy result in similar nutritional and clinical outcome, and although there is no difference in the global quality of life, there might be difference in various domains of quality of life and various subdomains of the quality of life, and the tube complications should be discussed with the patients. As per the NCCN guidelines, the factor suggesting strongly in favor of a prophylactic PEG tube would be again severe weight loss, and if the patient is having symptoms of ongoing dehydration, anorexia, dysphagia, etc., patient anticipating high dose radiations, severe aspiration in patients, and if the patient is an elderly patient with compromised cardiopulmonary function. So the take home message, as far as the debate of PEG versus nasogastric tube is concerned, body weight is maintained similarly by both of these interventions. There is no difference between PEG and nasogastric tube. The risk of tube dislodgement is lower and quality of life is possibly better with PEG. This is something that we often see. Most of the patients come with complaining of the tube that has been removed during the sleep, and the patient has to go through the pain of introducing the tube again during the course of treatment. And nasogastric tubes are associated with less dysphagia and earlier weaning after completion of the radiotherapy. So because the nasogastric tube can be pulled out easily, we often have a role as a clinician. We have a role at motivating the patients to start taking orally so that we can pull the tube out and the patient can start relying on his swallowing functions again, which is not usually seen in case of PEG, PEG tube, and there is might be a chance of PEG dependence. And the risk of pneumonia and other infections like long-term swallowing functions after chemoradiotherapy for head and neck cancer seems to be similar in both the groups. Now coming to the last question of prophylactic versus reactive feeding. So when do we call it as a prophylactic feeding? When the intervention is done before the beginning of chemoradiation to reduce, to prevent weight loss and reduce dehydration and hospitalization, and to avoid treatment breaks. And when do we call it as a reactive feeding is when patients are supported with oral nutrition and supplements. And when it is impossible to maintain all these orally, then we go ahead with a tube insertion, is what is known as a reactive feeding. Okay, so now coming to the evidences for the same. So as far as nutritional outcome is concerned, there is a similar decrease in BMI and in both the groups, reactive versus So as far as nutritional outcome is concerned, there is a similar decrease in BMI in both the groups. As far as the cells, the Salas et al., some of the studies have shown that the weight loss is slightly higher in patients receiving reactive PEG as compared to the prophylactic PEG. Some studies have said that there is no difference in the weight loss. And some of the studies have showed, most of the studies have said that there is not much difference between the, as far as weight loss is concerned. However, some of the studies have shown that reactive is associated with a significant, a slightly higher weight loss. As far as interruption of treatment is concerned, some of the studies did not assess the same, and other studies did not find any difference between the these two modalities as far as the prophylactic and reactive insertion of tube is concerned. Salas et al. Said that survival is not although the survival was not assessed, but the quality of life was at 6 months was better in the prophylactic group. And in the Lewis et al., they have said that patients with a prophylactic PEG had a higher proportion of chemotherapy cycles as compared to the reactive PEG. So these patients with were prophylactically peg was inserted did end up taking more cycles of chemotherapy. Some other studies, dealing with some of the other studies separately. So this study by Bashnagel et al. Concluded that PEG tube placed prophylactically were associated with lower rates of stricture, aspiration, hospitalization, and cost of treatment as compared to those placed reactively. A study by Hughes et al. They concluded that prophylactic gastrostomy tube in patients with high-risk head and neck cancer resulted in a significant decrease in hospital admissions and length of stay, and led to increased bed availability. So from all of these discussions, the take-home message would be, as far as the outcome, the outcome, the interruption of radiation and the outcome is concerned, there is not much difference between prophylactic feeding and reactive feeding, but there is a difference in the stricture rate, aspiration rate, and significantly higher rate of hospitalizations is seen when the PEG tube is inserted reactively as compared to prophylactic group. So prophylactically, if the PEG tube is inserted, it leads to less number of hospital admissions during the course of treatment, and that is cost effective. But as far as treatment break is concerned, there is not much difference between the two modalities. So even as per the Australian guideline, prophylactic enteral feeding should be considered to improve nutritional status, cost, and patient outcome for patients who have T4 or hypopharyngeal tumors undergoing concurrent chemoradiation, because these patients would have tumor-related factors that are leading to obstruction. And for them, a prophylactic enteral feeding would be indicated. And for other patients, reactive feeding would be good enough modality. Now, what is the aim? So what would be the aim for the intervention? So the aim for the intervention as per the EQ guidelines would be to increase the energy intake by at least 30 kilocalorie per kg per day as per the energy requirement, and maybe elevated post-operatively, and the weight should be monitored and adjusted as per the patient's as per the patient requirement. And the protein intake should be at least 1.2 kg per day, and the patient should have their weight monitored regularly to see if these are met or not. Now coming to the last topic in, so all the questions have been addressed, but the last topic as far as nutrition is concerned is the refeeding syndrome. What is exactly refeeding syndrome? Refeeding syndrome consists of metabolic disturbance that occurs as a result of reinstitution of nutrition to patients who are starved and severely malnourished or metabolically stressed due to severe illness. So this is something which is not solely related to oncology per se, but it is more than often seen in our set of patients who have been starved because of the ongoing treatment, etc. And it can occur, it's irrespective of the feeding route. So route doesn't matter. Refeeding syndrome usually occurs in 4 days of starting to refeed, and the derangement is limited to hyperphosphatemia and abnormal sodium and fluid balance, changes in glucose, protein and fat metabolism, thiamine deficiency, hypokalemia, and hypomagnesemia. The exact incidence is unknown, but there are some criteria of finding out if the patient is at a risk of developing refeeding syndrome. So if the BMI is less than 16 kg per meter square, if the unintentional weight loss is greater than 15% within the last 3 to 6 months, if there is little or no nutritional intake for more than 10 days, if there is low level of potassium, phosphate, or magnesium prior to feeding, or if the patient has two or more of the so the if patient has one or more of the fall the of the above points, or if the patient has two or more of the following points. So less than BMI less than 18.5 along with unintentional weight loss less greater than 10%, or a little or no nutritional intake for more than 5 days, and if the patient is having alcohol abuse or drugs, including insulin, chemotherapy, antacids, and diuretics. So if two or more of these factors are there, then the patient is as can be said to be at a high risk of refeeding syndrome, or if any one of these factors are present, then the patient is at a high risk of developing refeeding syndrome. What to do about the same patients to be identified if whether they are at a risk or not, and then potassium, calcium, and other electrolyte should be checked before feeding starts. Thiamine should be given 200 to 300 mg daily orally, and high vitamin B the vitamin B supplement should be given, and then the feeding should be start at a lower rate, and slow increase of feeding should be done over a period of 4 to 7 days, and rehydration again should be done carefully, and supplementation and supplement and correct levels of the levels of the potassium should be corrected, and then these levels of the electrolytes should be monitored over the next course of 2 weeks. Now coming to dysphagia and odynophagia, we'll be just touching on this these topics briefly. So the again for prevention of dysphagia and odynophagia would depends on the technique of the radiation and use of other radiation protective drugs, and early referral to evaluation by speech and language specialist should be done. It was already discussed. So there are several swallowing exercises like the Mendelsohn maneuver, shaker maneuver, the supraglottic swallow, and effortful swallow. We've already discussed about these maneuvers in the last class. Coming to the salivary gland dysfunction, xerostomia is defined as a subjective sensation of dryness of mouth, which is poorly correlated with objective measures of salivary gland dysfunction. Physiology is that saliva contains 90% of water, and a normal healthy adult produces around 600 ml to 1.5 liter of saliva per day, and the majority of it comes from the parotid, if you look into the stimulated and unstimulated saliva. In an unstimulated saliva is mainly from the majority is again from the submandibular glands, but for stimulated saliva the majority comes from the parotid glands. We won't be dealing with the pathophysiology in much details. Implications of xerostomia would be again the oral mucosa becomes dry, cracked, and painful in absence of salivation. There is an impaired mastication, speech gets impaired, sleep disruptions occur. The taste is again dependent on the production of saliva, so that again goes away. There is an altered microbial flora, and that leads to dental caries. So other teeth related effects are also seen as a result of xerostomia. And there is a low tolerance for dental prostheses, and patient receives need prostheses for absence of teeth in these in head and neck cancers, and again the swallowing is impaired. So management again for xerostomia is Again, depends on if the man that the steps to be taken before radiation, during radiation, and after radiation. So pre-treatment, the what to be determined is the risk versus benefit ratio of the treatment. It is we cannot spare the salivary gland at the risk of recurrence, but it has to be spared whenever possible. During treatment, protection of the glands can be done by giving amifostin, although it is not used routinely, but some of the books does mention about this. And the treatment technique is again one of the factors. And post-treatment mainly includes xylagogues and other artificial saliva. And one thing to be mentioned here, pre-treatment is the salivary gland transfer. There are various studies that have shown that salivary gland transfer before radiation can be an effective method to decrease xerostomia. So salivary, the xylagogues include pilocarpine and other drugs like neostigmine, nicotinic acid, etc. Pilocarpine is given 5 mg thrice daily. 7-milin is another acetylcholine analog and can be used for the same. And then we have the salivary substitutes that includes various artificial saliva containing mucin, sorbitol, xylitol, mineral salts, fluorides, and other preservatives. So these are the compositions of artificial saliva preparations that are present. And then other moistening agents can be used like sugarless gums and candies and frequent sip of liquids. That would increase the secretion of stimulated saliva rather than non-stimulated saliva. Pain management itself becomes a big topic in itself. So a question that comes in DNB exams is WHO stepladder analgesia. And this is essentially when, this essentially means that you start with a non-opioid adjuvant drug for pain. And if the pain is still persisting or increasing, then you go ahead with a very mild to moderate opioid along with or without non-opioid adjuvant. And if the pain is still persisting, then you go for a long-acting opioids along with a short-acting opioids and plus minus non-opioid adjuvants. So the opioid that is most commonly used is tramadol. There are other options like transdermal fentanyl and lastly morphine. Various preparations of morphine is available. Again, it can be long acting as well as short acting. Now coming to fatigue and mood dysfunction, cancer related fatigue is defined by NCCN as a distressing persistent subjective sense of physical, emotional, or cognitive tiredness or exertion related to cancer or cancer treatment that is not proportional to the recent activity and that interferes with usual function. The pathophysiology of fatigue itself is not well understood, but the good thing about it is that it decreases as soon as the treatment and treatment related complications goes away. So it is RT-induced fatigue is essentially short-lived and patient gets well after the end of the treatment. Management approach would be again asking the patient to increase activity. So if the patient should be asked to do whatever a patient likes to do, and that would again escape the fatigue. So distraction would work. A slight amount of rest and sleep therapy would work. Medications again in case of severe cases, and mostly, most commonly the thing that works is by asking the patient to increase activity and other counseling. coming to dental care, radiation-induced decay and necrosis and subsequent need for dental extraction is often seen. Prophylactic care decreases the incidence of all of this by one third, and an already decayed tooth should be extracted pre-treatment, and that is why before the starting of radiation, a referral to a dentist is must as far as head and neck radiation is concerned. And tooth decay is mainly due to the damage to the periodontal membrane. And other causes include decreased salivation and can be avoided by using of fluoride toothpaste. Eye and eye care, again, conjunctivitis is a side effect of treatment to radiation and usually not seen that much, but because it is often out of the field, but whenever dryness or itching is seen, can be managed with artificial tears. And the implications of treatment gap would be that there is a side effect, a treatment gap for a week may allow a recovery of the normal tissues, but it again is associated with a loss of tumor control by 1.4% for each day that each day that the overall treatment time is prolonged. So when necessary, should be used as an intervention at the cost of decreased in tumor control. That's all. Thank you. Any questions?